Hey guys, it's James here. After I posted my M4 Pro review video, I came across some criticisms in the comments and forums, had some productive discussions with some people, and I think I want to make this quick follow-up video to clarify some things and some of the rationale behind my testing methodologies. This is not to convince you or to say that I'm absolutely correct, but more so to show why I did things a certain way. This video is going to be a bit less structured than my usual fashion because it's more of a response and sharing my thoughts, but I put detailed timestamps in the description so you can see what are some of the things I addressed. First is the dropout protection in Studio One. I set it to high instead of maximum. Some people say it's unfair that I didn't set it to maximum while I set Cubase ASIO-Guard to high and I have Reaper's anticipative FX processing on. That is a valid criticism. First of all, I wasn't trying to deceive or make Studio One look worse on purpose. There is a reason why I showed the audio configurations. It's precisely to be transparent about how I set up the tests and to allow everyone to scrutinize my process and provide feedback. So keeping the dropout protection set to high was actually a deliberate decision I made in this video and also in my M3 Pro video last year with the purpose of reducing perceived variables. What I mean is that when you set the dropout protection to maximum, it will immediately display a clear 2048 buffer right here. Note that Studio One is the only DAW among the 7 I tested that would show you the process buffer size in clear numbers in samples. For a layperson like me watching, I would feel very confused because everywhere else in the video shows that this test was supposed to be a 1024 buffer test. I can guarantee you that if I set the dropout protection to maximum, there would be people saying it was unfair that I used a 2048 buffer in Studio One. So to keep all the buffer sizes on the screen consistent, I sacrificed being technically correct, and I still believe it was the right thing to do because it wouldn't have changed the results much anyway. I went back to Studio One and did the MSIM test and mixing into a mastering test with dropout protection set to maximum. And here are the results. As you can see, it really didn't make much of a difference anyway. It didn't make Studio One use efficiency cores. It didn't resolve the weird core utilization behaviors. So you can hear that the audio is crackling. This is on the M2 Pro. And right now I set the dropout protection to maximum. And I just added one extra track compared to when the dropout protection was set to high. And Studio One doesn't seem to be able to handle even one more track, even though I set the dropout protection to maximum. So here you can see that it doesn't really change how Studio One uses the cores. Still seeing some weird behavior in core 10, core 11, core 12. Only core 5, 6, 7, 8 are consistently being used. And most importantly, it didn't change the fact that the use of efficiency cores affect a DAW's performance on that chip, and therefore you might want to take that into account when buying a Mac. For example, for Studio One, regardless of what the dropout protection was set to, the test results show that a Studio One user on a 10-core M1 Pro Mac will most likely experience very little performance gain if they upgrade to the 12-core M3 Pro, at least according to my test results. So if you look at this graph, even out of context, there are two very clear patterns here. You can see that Reaper, Cubase, Pro Tools, and FL Studios, M1 Pro and M2 Pro, they performed the worst. Look at that, right? And M3 Pro is in the middle. There you go, middle, 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 in the middle. And then M4 Pro is just the best across. In contrast, if you look at Logic, Live, and Studio One, M1 Pro and M3 Pro, they perform very similarly. Look at this, right? Like this one here and this one here, and this one here and this one here, very similar, with M2 Pro being the worst. Over here, and over here. And these two different groups of patterns happen to coincide with the DAWs that can use fully use efficiency cores
and the DAWs that cannot.
So it's clear that efficiency core utilization is playing a role here. As a reminder again, Pro Tools used to not use efficiency cores, and now we can't, and there is undeniably a performance gain on the same chip after the update, as reported by Pro Tools users. So even if you disregard all my tests, there's evidence out there by other people showing that a DAW can process more audio when it can use the efficiency cores. Second thing I want to address is that some people have pointed out that the process buffers in my tests across all DAWs being different, despite the device buffer being the same. If you have no idea what I just said, that is exactly why I did the tests in a way that are as relatable and digestible to the average person. The majority of people simply don't know this really technical stuff, and that includes myself, by the way. So basically, some DAWs can use a larger buffer than the actual device buffer for audio processing scenarios like mixing, so you can do more in a project, which is a huge advantage for users of those DAWs, and is exactly why I kept those settings on, despite that doing so will make the comparison not exactly one-to-one on a technical level. But in real life, you simply wouldn't turn those settings off in typical usage. So to me, testing without those settings may be more technically correct, but the test results would be way less useful. Like as a Reaper user myself, if I see a test where someone disables the anticipative FX processing, I would probably not watch it simply because I never turn that off, and I know most Reaper users have that setting on. That setting is on by default for a reason. Let me tell you a quick story on how I even discovered this whole thing about the efficiency cores affecting DAW performance in the first place. I used to be exclusively a Reaper user, but then I decided to learn Logic Pro. And one of the best ways to learn a new DAW is to do your usual work in it, so I tried to make a full song in it, but somehow towards the last 20% in the mixing process, I started to get the system overload pop-ups, even with buffer size, processing thread, and processing range all set to as high as possible. I was really confused because I could mix the same project and even larger projects on the same computer in Reaper with absolutely no issues. This was how I discovered that on the same computer, you can actually get more performance from one DAW than another, thanks to performance boost features like Reaper's anticipative FX processing. Sure, it technically allows Reaper to run on a really large buffer, processing buffer, but that doesn't really matter. To me as a user, all I know is that I can do larger mixing projects in Reaper that I cannot in Logic on the same computer. So it is with this exact perspective in mind that I designed my tests. The bottom line is, if I were someone shopping for a Mac, I would want to know how much my specific DAW can get out of a chip. For example, if I were an Ableton Live user, I would want to know that my DAW cannot fully utilize the efficiency cores, so I should probably get a Mac with a chip that is either overall really powerful, like the M4 Pro, or if I'm already on an M1 Pro chip, I should probably not upgrade to a Mac with a M3 Pro chip because it wouldn't really get me any significant performance boost in Ableton Live. Conversely, if I were a Reaper user, knowing that my DAW can get 100% out of the chip means that I can get a lower end chip and maybe allocate some of my budget to SSD, RAM, or what have you. My testing just makes so much sense to me as a user and buyer, and I could tell it's the same for many of you as well, based on the overwhelmingly positive comments and emails I have received, which I really appreciate. But I guess the tests are indeed flawed when you look at it with a scientific lens, which is why in every single one of my videos, I say out loud that these are not scientific tests. Now, one thing I could have done better is that I could have compared the DAW against each other less, because these tests are not about showing one DAW being better than the other as a whole. I firmly believe that you should use a DAW that works the best with your creativity. I think I just got kind of carried away looking at the test data. That's on me, and I'll try to be more neutral in future videos. Just know that my M4 Pro video is not even about which DAW performs better than the other anyway. It's more about how much a specific DAW performs on four generations of Apple Silicon chips. You can actually just look at the test results only one single DAW, and can still get the same core message. pun unintended. For example, for Logic, because it doesn't use efficiency cores, it performs similarly on the 10-core M1 Pro, 10-core M2 Pro, and 12-core M3 Pro. The takeaway here is that for a Logic user on a 10-core M1 Pro Mac, it may be a mistake for them to upgrade to the 12-core M3 Pro Mac and expect a major performance boost. The matter of me not using technically the same process buffer across different DAWs isn't even relevant here, because we're just looking at one DAW. So I could have split the video into 7 different videos, each dedicated to a DAW, and the conclusions will still be the same. Lastly, I feel like it doesn't make sense to try to match the process buffer on a technical level anyway. Logic has no official documentations on what exactly the process buffer size is when you set it to large. There are people making guesses online, but there's just no official documentation from Apple that confirms anything. If there is and I just missed it, please let me know in the comments. I also feel like Logic has some kind of pre-rendering or render ahead function going on in the backend too that allows it to perform better than other DAWs that cannot use the efficiency cores, at least in my tests. There is also no documentation on that, and I don't think you can turn it off either. I feel like Pro Tools must also have similar features, allowing it to perform nearly as well as Reaper now, but I don't think there is a setting for you to turn that off. So it might not even be possible to do a technically correct one-to-one comparison. At the end of the day, my goal is to give a practical reference point to help people doing music production get the best Mac for their money. This stuff isn't cheap, and once you factor in currency conversions and RAM or SSD upgrades, it can be hard to figure out how to allocate your budget. I hope that clears some things up, and you're very welcome to disagree. Constructive criticism is always welcome here, and I'll continue to improve my testing methodologies and how I communicate my points in the future. As always, I truly appreciate all your support, and I'll see you next time.